Assalamu alaikum, welcome back class. In today's discourse session, so today we are going to talk about the cooperative principle. As you know that this topic is we have covered in earlier in physical class, right? But still I am going to talk about this because most of the students were absent at that very day, and we have actually read it from the book that we are dealing with, the name of Discourse by Guy Cook. So over here I'm going to explain the cooperative principle again. So you'll see that we have said we usually perform many functions with the help of language. We the human beings, we actually do everything with the help of language. So language performs many function. So keeping in view all those functions, you'll see that one of the important most function of our language is communication. So the moment we are communicating with one another, actually we are cooperating one another as well. So keeping in view the concept of this cooperation, this actually bond, this relation, you'll see that we follow some of the principles that are actually not known to us, but still we usually follow them. So these are actually the principles that are given by Paul Grice in his philosophy, right? So with the name of that, we from that section we have developed this principle, that is the cooperative principle. So let us look at it from this area. This is actually the thing that I already have shared with you, the compressed form of discourse analysis, and it's page number 14 and 15. It's already available in Google Classroom. You can check the page number 14-15 from there, right? So let us take the example first and then we'll jump towards the cooperative principle. So look at a classical example, the conversation taken from Pragmatics by George Yule. Author is starting this unit with the help of an example that he has taken from the book of George Yule, that is actually Pragmatics, right? So it's at page number 36. He says that there is a woman sitting on a park bench and a large dog laying on the ground in front of the bench. A man comes along and sits down on the bench. This actually example is given to you people as well in one of the physical class that was related to discourse, I think. So you'll see that keeping in view that example, man says, does your dog bite? Woman, no. The man reaches down to pat the dog. The dog bites the man's hand. Man, hey, you said your dog doesn't bite. Woman, he doesn't, but that's not my dog. So you'll see that this is the actually one of the comic, or we can say that funny conversation, that is actually given by George Yule in his book Pragmatics at page number 36. So where lies a problem, and what are the things that make this conversation funny one? Let's check it out. Let's analyze it. One of the problems with this exchange has to do with communication, right? There is a sort of communication gap between the participants. You'll see that I have already told you that there are always two important participants in a successful sort of communication. One is speaker and second one is listener, right? So you'll see that the problem was caused by the man's assumption that the dog belonged to the woman. So it indicates that there is no shared knowledge between the two participants. I already talked about the shared knowledge. You have this idea about the shared knowledge. So keeping in view that shared knowledge, you see that there is a sort of communication gap between the two participants, that is the woman and the old man or the man, right? From the man's perspective, the woman's answer provides less information than expected. So this is one of the actually important debate of the area of Pragmatics, that we usually communicate more than what we say, right? So the same is the case with that woman, that she provides less information in her answer. So of course, if she had the story, wouldn't be funny. If she provides we can say that the less information, then this is the element that gives the element of fun to the story. So for the story to be funny, the woman has to give the less information than is expected. The whole situation points out that there is an expected amount of information provided in conversation, and the assumption is that people involved in a conversation will cooperate with each other. So whenever two participants in a communication, they usually exchange their ideas, information, they give information, they talk to each other, they actually cooperate one another, right? So you'll see that in Yule's example, the woman clearly does not want to take part in any cooperative interaction, but in most cases you'll see that the assumption of cooperation is common to all conversations, so that it can be defined as a cooperative principle of conversation. So whenever we actually communicate to one another, we usually cooperate with one another, and we usually follow a principle with the name of cooperative principle. So this is further subdivided into four sub principle called maxims by the English language philosopher Paul Grace in 1975. I have earlier discussed this thing in a physical class, that this philosophy, this we can say that actually this principle is given by Paul Grice in 1975. According to Grice, speakers and hearers, they share the cooperative principle. Speakers shape their utterances to be understood by hearers. So if there is, we can say that shared knowledge between the participants, then that cooperation can be possible. To keep this thing in mind, then Grice analyzes cooperation as involving four maxims. According to Paul Grice, there is the involvement of four different maxims. One is quantity, quality, relation, and manner. Speakers give enough and not too much information. This is related to quantity, right? Whenever the speaker speaks, right, he gives enough information, that is the information that is needed, nothing more than that. Then this can be called as the maxim of quantity. Then they are genuine and sincere, speaking truth or facts, right? This thing we have earlier discussed, that whenever we speak, we actually believe to one another that one is speaking the truth. So the speech that we made is genuine and sincere, so we usually follow the maxims of quality. Then utterances are relative to the context of the speech. So whatsoever we speak with the help of, we can say that, our relation, and that can be called as the maxim of relation, right? We usually utter the things that are related to a particular topic, not more than that. We don't deviate from the norms. Then the speakers try to present meaning clearly and concisely, avoiding ambiguity. So this would be called as the manner, maxim of manner. So these are the four maxims. Grice cooperative principle set of norms expected in conversation match Grice four maxims expected in conversation with their corresponding definitions. So here is a sort of little bit activity that you people have to perform. You'll see that here is on the one side there is the name of those maxims, and on the other hand there is the definitions, right? So this is the activity that you have to perform after listening the lecture. You have to relate the maxims with their suitable definitions. So this is your activity to do. So next you'll see that McGuand proposes that Grice four maxims establish important norms of discourse that different genres and strategies play with. Joke and tale tellers play with language. So now this is one of the critics, McGuand. He is of the philosophy that the maxims that are actually given by Grice are very important in a particular, in any discourse, and it is mostly used in different genres of literature as well, and in the strategies to tell the tall tales and the jokes as well. So this all is actually to play with the language. They banned the ordinary structures and assumptions about speech. According to this man, the storytellers and the joke tellers, they actually do what? They bend the ordinary structure of the language. They bend, they mold, they reshape the ordinary structure. And we usually assume about, we make assumptions about that speech, that this would be the suitable meaning of the particular speech, right? Just to give, we can say that the poetic function to the language. right? So McVaughn argues that much joking and tall tale development involve the tellers playing with these four maxims of Christ's cooperative principle. So according to him, that Mike, that person, that is who is McVaughn, he according to his argument, the moment the storytellers, the tale tellers or long tale tellers or the joke tellers, they usually actually play with the maxims of this man Grice, right? Over here he is going to give us an example from one of the storyteller. He says that Orville Hicks, he's a storyteller, right? In a tale of flowing the popcorn, Field elaborates details about his father and the mule. So this is the name of the story, Flowing of the Popcorn. This person Orville has written a lot of we can say that funny stories, so you can read out them. So you see that in this story, the tale of blowing the popcorn, so the whole we can say that this story is about the description of how the popcorns are we can say that put together, how they are blown and how they are actually made. This whole story deals with all these details. So over here in that story, you'll see that this person Hicks gives the detail about his father and his mule, right? He says that these realistic details set us up for the tall tale exaggeration of weather being so that the corn started to pop. So apparently in the earlier part of the story, he gives us some realistic sort of details. So the exaggerations that he has made are actually realistic one, but later on you'll see that the exaggeration that he has made, that exaggeration of the weather, that how he exaggerates the weather, how with the help of hyperbolic sort of statements he exaggerates the weather. He says that being so hot that corn started to pop, right? This is something we can say that exaggeration, how popcorns can be, we can say that, pop up with the help of weather. So this is the exaggeration. Over Orwell in fact adds no more realistic details. There was so much popcorn it created a blizzard, right? Then he again gives more detail about those popcorns. He says that there was so much popcorns in that area that it created a blizzard. We mean actually the snowstorm. So everywhere there is we can say that the availability of popcorns. So this is actually called as exaggeration. This is how we usually violate, this is how we usually exaggerate the rules that are actually there. So he goes beyond the maximum of quantity. He gives us more than we need to know. This is how author is relating this example with the help of this short story, that how actually the writer violates, goes beyond the maximum of quantity. Then all Orwell's tall tales also violate quality. He purposely speaks untruths, yet he gives seemingly factual details. He plays with the relation, often creating crazily logical connection. So you'll see that Grice's final maxim manner demands that conversation be unambiguous, that there should be clarity in the conversation. This is the demand of the final maxim of Grice. But you'll see that, but Orwell's tall tales bend the meanings of the words for humor. So it's up to the writer that how he or she bends up, we can say that, the meanings of the word, just to creating the fun, just to creating fun, humor in a particular story, joke, whatsoever he or she is writing. Then he plays with words and images as well. Orwell Hicks plays with these four maxims of the cooperative principle in his performances. So in short, we can say that whenever we are in these areas, we usually not only we follow the principles but also we violate them as well. But most of the cases it is most dominant in jokes and dark tales, right? Often the appropriate incongruity of humor in such tale depends on the violation or tampering with the four maxims of Gray's cooperative principle. So whenever we are actually creating humor in tales or something like that, we are usually doing what? We are violating or tampering the four maxims that are given by Gray's: quantity, quality, relation, and manner. Overall, these simple conversational rules are very useful, both when they are followed and when they are noticeably broken. So earlier we have discussed that that these rules are actually these are very much like the grammar rules that are there in mind of grammar of the native language, right? We usually we don't know the rules, but we still follow them. For a successful sort of communication, we are always in need of, we can say that, that cooperation. Whenever we have to speak with someone, whenever we have to conversate, we usually follow these principles, these four principles of quantity, quality, relation, and manner. So this can be called as cooperation, and this can be called as cooperative principle that is given by Paul Grice. Okay, girls, thank you. In case of any confusion, you can read out this chunk from the compressed form of discourse that is already shared in Google Classroom. It's page number 14 and 15. You have to read out the material from the book that is already with you of Guy Cook, right? So that's much as enough for today.